I apologize that it's 70 degrees outside in the middle of winter, and it's a little warm in here. I tried to crack some windows, get some air flowing for you guys, and I realized that the heat was on, so I just turned the heat off in here. Thanks for the ushers telling me that. I think the heat's on. All right. Well, I, growing up, was a sucker for a good 80s love rock ballad. Maybe these words are familiar to you. Wherever you go, whatever you do, I will be right here waiting for you. The great words of Bryan Adams, right? Or how about this one? Hello, is it me you're looking for? I can see it in your eyes. I can see it in your smile. And I want to tell you so much. I love you. I thought you were going to say it for me. Later on, when I got to college and I met that special someone, though, this one really spoke to me. Oh, Sherry, our love holds on, holds on. Now, for some of you more experienced folks, maybe this one really resonates more with you. Love me tender, love me sweet. Oh, I hear amens now. What's going on? Never let me go. You have made my life complete, and I love you so. Now, there's some modern classics as well, such as, and when you smile, the whole world stops and stares for a while, because you're amazing just the way you are. The words of the great Bruno Mars, all right? Or this one, which sounds really strange to me, hello from the outside. At least I can say that I've tried to tell you I'm sorry for breaking your heart, but it don't matter. It clearly doesn't tear you apart anymore. It doesn't sound very loving to me. But it's only a one-word name, some philosopher named Adele. So I don't know who that is. Now, there's something about the love songs and the love movies and the romance that it impacts almost all of us to some extent. There's something about it that kind of gets to us, can bring us joy, can bring us inspiration, can even bring us heartbreak. And I think that there's a reason why this concept of love and romance makes such a powerful impact on our lives. And it's this: we were made to love and be loved. It's very simple. We were created for this. We were made to love and to be loved. And when either of those gets broken or taken away in some way, it will wreck us. It does some crazy things to us when that happens. Now, in case you're thinking, that sounded very Hallmark card-esque. I don't know if that's really true. Let me go to the Word of God here. First of all, we were created by God, and God literally says He made us in His image. It says so in Genesis 1:27. So God created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created him. Male and female, He created them. We were made in the image of God. But the Bible also says that God is love. 1 John 4:8. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. So if God is love and God created us in His image, then we were hardwired for love. We were hardwired to not only be loved, but to offer love. The Bible teaches that. And I believe that's why when people who were kind of trying to challenge and question Jesus, especially the leaders of Judaism, the ones who were experts in the law, they tried to pin Jesus down and say, okay, of all the commandments in the Old Testament, in the Torah, give us the most important one, the most important one. And He said this. In Mark 12:29 through 31, Jesus replied, "The most important commandment is this: Listen, O Israel, the Lord our God is the one and only Lord, and you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. The second is equally important: love your neighbor as yourself. No other commandment is greater than these." So of all the things Jesus commands us, He narrows all the commandments down to these two things. They both invoke this thing that we call love. So there's no way around this one. Love is a necessity in our lives. Therefore, it's important that we get our relationships right. So that's why we're diving into this new sermon series called Relationship Hacks. And if you take nothing away over these next 4 weeks when we do this, if you take nothing away, I want you to take this one thing away. Real love is worth the work. Real love is worth the work. Because guess what? To love the way Jesus teaches us to love, to love the way real love is described in the Bible, that does not come naturally. And I think this is our big problem right now in our culture, and it has been for quite some time. We just believe this is all going to be so natural. To love the way God created us to love, to love the way the Bible describes love actually is, to experience real love, we just think it's going to be natural for some reason. And if it doesn't, it don't seem right. If it doesn't, we won't write songs about that. You know, we rarely find love songs that talk about really making it where you roll up your sleeves and you dig in and you put in the hard work so that real love actually happens. Well, friends, with the help of God through His Word and through us being together over these next 4 weeks, we're going to do just that. We're going to challenge ourselves to get to work because real love is actually worth the work. And the alternative, if we decide to be lazy, if we decide we're not going to put in the work, if we decide we're just going to see what comes natural, let me tell you, if you don't work at real love, you will only have relationships that are required, necessary, or unhealthy. And let me give you examples. Required, where someone says this, well, we are married, and I know God does not want me to divorce him, so I guess I'm just stuck. Now, I ain't making that kind of stuff up. Those things get said. I've heard these words. A relationship that's just required or necessary, like this one. Well, we work in the same office, so I have to try to get along, but I just can't stand them. Now, nobody in here ever has thought that, right? Right? I wonder how many here in the church office think that about me. That's necessary. Necessary relationship. Unhealthy. Like someone saying this, I know he treats me horribly, but I could never live without him. I'll never leave him. And if you don't work at real love, that's our relationships. Required, necessary, unhealthy. And friends, I don't know about you, but if we were made to love and be loved, we need to get this kind of stuff right. We need to figure this out. We need to work on these relationships. So that's why we came up with this sermon series, Relationship Hacks. And in the video you saw some what they call life hacks. And what is a hack? It's something anyone can do with just a little bit of ingenuity to make life better. That's what a life hack is. And my favorite life hack that was on the screen is totally the cupcake one. Man, that changed my life when I saw that online. I'm like, oh, that's a great idea. And it is. It's like a little icing sandwich. It's so awesome. The only time it ever failed me is one time I cut into the bottom of that thing, and it was a cream-filled cupcake, and it made a mess. I still ate it. It was messy, but it was the only fail on that hack. So we're going to do the same thing with relationships, something anyone can do with just a little bit of work that will make your relationships better. It's that simple. So we're going to give you a relationship hack today and the next 3 Sundays after, all right? So here's the first one. Regulate criticism. Regulate criticism. Now, I'm going to actually begin by saying criticism in and of itself isn't always bad. For instance, because generals are critical of their soldiers, our country is safer. Right? And because restaurant managers are critical of their employees, our food and service is healthier and better. Because attending physicians are critical of their resident physicians, our health care is better. So even if you have a strong aversion to all criticism, I want to pause to you and say, criticism in and of itself isn't bad. Criticism can be a very, very good thing. However, criticism can turn bad. People can be overly critical, or as I've heard it called, have a critical spirit about them and just be seemingly critical all the time. And this is what we want to guard against. This is what we want to work against. So as I've tried to discern what the difference is between the good kind of criticism and the bad kind of criticism, I've been able to see, and maybe you've noticed this too, you can kind of narrow it down to two factors: motive and delivery. So you need to regulate criticism in your life by checking your motive and improving your delivery, okay? Now, before I explain any of that, we're going to dive into those two concepts together as in our time together today, but I want to pause to actually give you the relationship hack from God's Word itself, right here in the Bible. We're going to be looking at 1 Corinthians 13, starting at verse 4 in just a moment, but if you aren't familiar with this, this chapter is known as the love chapter in the Bible. It is an awesome chapter. I've read it quite a few times. I've read it at a lot of weddings. It is absolutely, unequivocally, the most accurate and the most beautiful description of love you will find anywhere on the planet. Hands down. So I encourage you to read the whole chapter. We're going to read just 3.5 verses, starting in verse 4. And here's what it says. It says, love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. Now, let me back up for just a moment. And each one of these little phrases really speak to the problem of motive and delivery. For instance, love is patient. That's delivery. Love is kind. That's delivery. If you deliver your criticism with kindness, that kind of helps. Does not envy. That speaks to motive. Does not boast. That speaks to motive. It is not proud. That speaks to the motive of all motives. Perhaps the biggest, most painful motive that breaks down love is probably pride. Does not dishonor others. That's delivery. Is not self-seeking. That's motive. Is not easily angered. That's delivery. And maybe a root cause of some of our criticism. Keeps no record of wrongs. That's motive. Does not delight in evil. That's motive. And in the very last part of that little passage, we see some of the most awesome motives you could ever have for giving criticism, actually. Rejoicing with the truth, always protecting, always trusting, always persevering. Some of the most amazing motives for giving criticism. So, since we're on the topic of motives, let's sort of deal with that first. Make sure you are critical for God's sake and their sake, not your sake. Let me say that again. Make sure you are critical for God's sake and their sake, not your sake. In other words, are you being critical because it is the godly thing to do? Are you being critical and you're saying what you're saying because it is the most loving thing to do for that person? Or are you being critical because you get something out of that? And we don't always say, I want to get something out of this, therefore let me criticize. We don't always do that. And the problem is we don't usually actually think at all before we offer the criticism. But sometimes when we offer criticism, we do it because genuinely it makes us feel better. Or it makes us look better. Or it keeps me in charge. Or it fulfills some anger. I mean, sometimes it's like, I felt better to get that off my chest because I was ticked off. And so we say that. Or sometimes it's just a pride issue. That pride wells up within us and we got to just offer, now I tell you what I feel. Let me give you my 2 cents. And why are we harping on this? Why is this important? I'm going to give you a couple little formulas to think about. When it comes to your relationships, this is very important. First formula is this. Criticism plus time equals repulsion. I struggled. I almost wanted to put the word erosion in there. Because you can take the strongest of rocks, and every minute, every few seconds maybe, just let one drop of water hit the same spot. Eventually, over time, you're going to find that that water has done some serious damage to that rock. That's just a reality. And friends, in our relationships, if you tend to be critical, and you are critical over and over And over again, I don't care how strong that love was in the beginning, there's going to come a point where the person, that rock, is going to want to run away from you, going to be repulsed by you. And I've heard many times people say things like, I just can't make her happy, so I've given up. Or I can't do anything right. Can't do anything right. And because of that, I don't even feel anything anymore. Or I'm so tired of hearing it that I don't even want to be around him. These are real sentences, real statements that I've heard from real people. And again, I'm not trying to say we should never offer constructive criticism. In fact, let me give you this formula. Criticism plus encouragement plus humility plus time equals respect. You can still offer criticism. But when that criticism is offered in the midst of a relationship that's been sweetened by words of encouragement over time, that's coming from a person who at other times in the relationship has admitted their own faults as well, then over time, that kind of criticism is seen in a very respectful light. You can respect that criticism. So let me give you something to do here. If you tend to be a critical person, and you think this could be a blind spot for you, and maybe you don't think that way. Maybe I need to say this for those who don't think they're a critical person. Because I've met a lot of critical people who don't think they're critical. Because they're never critical of themselves, but they're critical of everybody else. I don't know what makes you think there's something wrong with me, but I can tell you what's wrong with you thinking I'm critical. So let me rephrase myself here. Maybe if you don't think you have a critical bone in your body, maybe you need to listen up. I want you to look at that passage of 1 Corinthians 13 again. And I want you to look at the word love, or the pronoun it. And I want you to put your name in place of that. And I wonder if your wife or your husband or your child or your parent could at least sometimes, I'm not even going all the time, just sometimes say these words about you. I'll take one for the team here. Let me reread this. Could Sherry or Molly or Cameron say, Bill is patient. Bill is kind. Bill does not envy. Bill does not boast. Bill is not proud. Bill does not dishonor others. Bill is not self-seeking. Bill is not easily angered. Bill keeps no record of wrongs. Bill does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. Bill always protects. Bill always trusts. Bill always hopes. Bill always perseveres. And I won't even say Bill never fails, because that's not even happening. It's an interesting thing to think about, isn't it? And I can already hear the voices in your head saying, psh, you know, I'm just not a patient person. I'm just wasn't wired that way. I'm not patient. I got a little bit of a temper. And people who know me and love me know that's just how I am. That's just how I am. That's just how I am. There's a theological word for that. Cop out. That is a huge cop out. I don't see any footnotes, asterisks on here saying, here's some exceptions. There are a few people who are okay to be the opposite of this whenever they want, because that's just how they are. We need to lose that. You need to regulate criticism in your life by checking your motive and improving your delivery. Let's talk about delivery for a little bit. Here's some relationship hacks to help you think about your delivery. I'm going to give you two questions to ask yourself. And maybe, just maybe, if we were to pause, hit the pause button before we say what we want to say, and ask these two questions, maybe it will help. The first question is this. Could they understand my motive by the words that I choose here? Assuming your motive's good. If your motive is to help, if your motive is to love someone enough to say these words, then can they get your motive by the words you're choosing? If not, then you might want to rethink your words. If they can't discover your good motive in the midst of those words. Here's a second question. It's very simple. Would I want them to talk to me that way? Man, that one enough will trump a lot of the things we are about to say. Would I want them to talk to me that way? And you know what's ironic? Some of my friends who are the most critical people I know hate criticism. And it's funny because I've heard them say some very stinging words to people, and I'm like, man, oh man. That had some power and pack and explosion to it. And then I hear someone else say an eighth of that to them, much different scenario, and they're like, I can't even believe that. What's wrong with them? I'm like, that's not fair, man. Those who are really critical love the rocket launcher, but if you come at them with a water pistol, they're like, oh, I can't believe you, you know? I don't know what's happening with that. But if those who are critical would just actually put themselves in the skin of the person on the other end of that barrel and say, would I want someone to say these words in that way to me? That's a great question. It's a great diagnostic question. Now, don't hear me say this, because this is a peeve of mine. I do believe we have an oversensitive culture and society today a little bit, right? And it's getting a little bit too far. Man, I don't want you to hear me say, let's not ever offer criticism, because you know what? That's not even love. I'm not saying that at all. The last thing I want you to do is have a conversation with your spouse. It's like, honey, I've been wanting to talk about something that maybe, if you don't mind, just kind of praying about. It's probably not you. It's probably me. But if you could just consider, you know, I really think that we might be able to have a better marriage if you would just maybe, you know, stop committing adultery. You know what? I shouldn't have brought it up. That's my fault. That's my fault. I'm so sorry. Pretend I didn't even say that. Man, if you're walking on those kind of eggshells, forget that. That is not what we're talking about today. And while we're at it, let me give you one more little pet peeve of mine, other than the oversensitivity thing. Another one is, and man, I've said this, so this is confessional. We do this a lot, and I hear parents do this a lot. I love you, but fill in the blank. Because it makes us feel better to offer the criticism we want to give if we put I love you in front of it. It's like, I told you I loved you. I mean, what more do you want? Now, you drive me crazy. I love you, but you drive me crazy, right? Guess what? When you say the word crazy, they have forgot the words I love you already. But here's what's true about that. You're actually negating love when you say those words. And I've said those words because it makes me feel better to say I love you before I offer criticism. I love you, but the right thing to do, if we really want to get this right, is to say, I love you, so I need to tell you, fill in the blank. That communicates love. And it will probably change the words we use after the word but there. If we say, I love you, so I need to tell you this. It's going to change that. So lose I love you, but. Got to get rid of that. That's bad. Having said that, I want to, as we sort of wind down talking about delivery here, three things that I like to call relationship killers. What they really are, these are delivery systems. These are delivery systems that we use to deliver the criticism that we have in our heart, we have in our mind, and we deliver it in this way. I'm here to tell you, these delivery systems, they can be killers of relationships. The first one is a very, very culturally accepted thing, sarcasm. Sarcasm. The culture loves sarcasm. I kind of love sarcasm sometimes. I think it's funny. But it's a silent killer. I don't know if you should just get outside of your, you know, mind and heart and observe people conversing with one another and observe the reactions and the responses. I'm here to tell you, sarcasm is a silent killer. Because the only people that really, really think it's funny is the one giving it, and the innocent bystanders that it has nothing to do with are like, that it was a good one. That was a good one. That was funny. And the one that it was aimed at, they're like, ha, 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 ha. But deep down, that hurts. They can't stand it. I tell you, I've talked to people and the kids, when their parents are dripping with sarcasm, man, the kids hate that. They hate that. Sarcasm is a delivery system that will literally erode a marriage, erode a relationship. Another one is nagging. Nagging. Cannot let it go. Keep it going. If I just tell them one more time, if I just get on them one more time, I'm here to tell you that's called death by nagicide. Nobody likes that. It does not do well. Does not do well. So watch for that one. And then a third one, rants or lectures. This is my blind spot, man. I remember one time catching myself explaining to Molly not only what she had done wrong, but why it was wrong and the history of its wrongness over the centuries. And I remember I just had a moment, and I think it was the Holy Spirit of God opening my eyes to watch as her countenance, the Bible in the King James Version sometimes says their countenance fell. It's a real strange way to say that, but that's a good way to describe what you can watch happen to the people you love as you deliver your criticism in one of these three ways. You can literally watch their countenance fall. The spirit just breaks a little. They die a little inside, like, he won't stop talking. I remember literally sitting on the edge of the bed in my daughter's room and catching myself do that. And I said, you know what? I am so sorry. I have lectured the fire out of you. That was wrong. I'm going to stop now, and I love you. I'll see you later. She was probably very grateful for that. She said nothing back about that. But this is what we can do, and it can kill relationships. Even when you have good criticism to offer, and it's good, if you deliver it the wrong way, you can literally break the spirit and the relationship if you're not careful. So why is all this so important? Why are we harping on all this today? I hope you found this to be very practical, because the point of all this is God created us to love and be loved. Therefore, our relationships, we need to get those right. And most of our issues come down to broken relationships. Ultimately, the most important one of all, your relationship with the one who made you. So we've got to get relationships right. Real love is worth the work. So that's why this is so important. It's why Jesus gave us the two greatest commandments, and both invoked us to love. But I'm going to go one step further today. Why is this so important? Because when we really love each other, we give Northern Kentucky a glimpse of God. We give them a glimpse of God. 1 John 4:12 says, no one has ever seen God. But if we love each other, God lives in us, and his love is brought to full expression in us. That's how they see God. Through us loving, real love. Actual real love. Friends, this isn't just to make your life better. This isn't just to make your relationships better. This is mission critical for the gospel and its advancement in this world. So friends, maybe, just maybe, it's time for you to start regulating criticism in your life, because real love is worth the work. As we close our time together, I want to give you some potential next steps to take. We like to close with that idea every single time, because I don't want you leaving here saying, that was kind of cool. Man, I want you to leave here ready to do something. I want you to leave here ready to roll up your sleeves and actually get to work on love. Get to work on showing real love to the people in your lives. The first next step I want to offer you is this. Accept God's love. This is so big. This is so important. I wish I'd have had it on the screen. Man, you need to write this down. You, listen, you can't give love you don't have. And for a lot of us, that's the root problem. If you feel like for some reason this love thing just ain't working for me, maybe you have a deficit of love. And let me introduce you to the one who's got all the love you could ever hold. The one who made you. The one whom the Bible says is love himself. That's God. And for somebody in this room, you may have never taken your first step of faith in believing in Jesus, trusting in him and him alone for your salvation. I'm here to tell you, when you enter into a relationship with God Almighty, he will begin to pour out his love inside of you, and you'll be able to love like you've never loved before. People will think you're strange because of how you do relationships differently. So that might be the next step that you have, is to begin accepting God's love. If you've never placed your trust in Jesus Christ, I invite you today to just call upon his name. Like it says in Romans 10:13, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. It says in John 3:16 that God loved the world so much that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. So if you've never placed your faith in him, right where you're sitting, you can say, okay, I'm done doing life my way. Jesus, save me. Jesus, come into my life. Pour out your love inside of me. If you've never done that, I invite you to do that today. Because it's the only way you're going to love the way God created you to love. You can't give love you don't have. So accept God's love. Maybe you've done that. And maybe a next step for you today is to ask God to transform your motive. I know a lot of people who love God, but they struggle loving people the way they should. Their motives are out of kilter. They want people to see them as significant. They want people to see them in a certain light. And in order for them to be seen in a certain way, they speak a certain way. And it can be very critical of others. Their motives are out of whack. And God can transform our motives if we ask Him and say, God, help me to stop doing things for my sake and start doing things for your sake and for other people's sake, not my sake. Ask Him to transform your motive. And another way to do this, another step you can take, is to ask others to help improve your delivery. That is the best way to improve your delivery. Don't ask yourself. Don't look in a mirror and say, I thought that was good. Don't trust yourself. Get with your spouse if you're married. Get with your child if you're a parent. Get with your parent if you're a child. Get with a friend. Get with a coworker. Get with someone that you know is real with you, and they're going to be real with you, not going to tell you what you want to hear, and say, let me just tell you, here's how I would say this. Is that okay? And let them speak into you about how you deliver your criticism. And then lastly, maybe you're doing those kinds of things, but maybe what you needed to hear today is the idea that by the way you love, by the way you get your relationships right, you're actually being a part of a mission. So your next step would be to embrace that mission. The mission to show everyone you meet a glimpse of God. And the way you do that is by how you regulate your criticism to others. We live in a very critical society. I laughed at that first video we showed as you came in. Hopefully you got to see it. We can be like that. Loving Jesus, but being so angry and critical of others. And it can be funny, actually. But what if it's silently killing a relationship that you have? You were made to love and be loved. And to experience that love, it's going to take some work. But friends, real love is worth the work. In fact, let me close with this. God rolled up His sleeves and got to work so that you could have a good relationship with Him. And He worked Himself to the grave for you and for me. The least we can do is to regulate our criticism of others. Let's pray.